Glory in the highest heaven, to the Father and the Son and the Spirit He has given. Hallowed be the three in one.
Good morning, everyone. I'll invite you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Revelation. We're going to continue on this morning in chapter 13. I'm just going to adjust this here. Chapter 13 of Revelation, we're going to look at the latter part of that passage this morning. And as we prepare to go in that, as you're turning there, I would remind you that chapter 12 and 13 have kind of present to us a contrast of chapters 4 and 5 of Revelation. In chapter 4 and 5 of Revelation, we were introduced to God's throne, and on that throne we had the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and all of His beauty presented to us. In chapters 12 and 13, we have this parody going on where you have the dragon, who is Satan, and the first and the second beast. And so we have presented to us this kind of unholy Trinity that's at work in the world. And as we look at the latter half of the passage today, at the second beast, I would call your attention to how he's described. Because he's described much like the Holy Spirit. You'll see as we read through this, but this beast, right, is concerned with bringing attention to the first beast, just like the Holy Spirit is concerned with bringing attention to Christ. The Holy Spirit's job is to guide into all truth. This beast guides people to believe all the lies of the first beast and the dragon. The Holy Spirit is at work in the world, it says, to convict of sin and righteousness and judgment. This beast is at work in the world to lead into sin, lead into unrighteousness, and yet have it seem like a good and a godly thing. We'll read how this beast gives life to the image of the first beast and makes its words come alive. It makes the image speak, just like the Holy Spirit gives life to the words of Christ in our hearts. And so this is a very, it's an interesting thing going on here, and this beast is very deceptive. But I'll invite you now to stand to your feet as we read from verse 11. To the end of the chapter here. So verse 11 begins, "Then I saw another beast rising out of the earth. It had two horns like a lamb, and it spoke like a dragon. It exercises all the authority of the first beast in its presence, and makes the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast, whose mortal wound was healed. It performs great signs, even making fire come down from heaven to earth in front of people, and by the signs that it is allowed to work in the presence of the first beast, it deceives those who dwell on the earth, telling them to make an image for the beast that was wounded by the sword and yet lived." And again, if I just pause there, this reference to the wound and the seeming revival back to life again, we could see that as a reference to the Roman Empire that was once on the brink of destruction, then seemed to come back to life. So this is what this is getting at. It carries on in verse 15. "And it was allowed to give breath to the image of the first beast, so that the image of the beast might even speak and might cause those who would not worship the image of the beast to be slain. It also causes all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both free and slave, to be marked on the right hand or the forehead, so that no one can buy or sell unless he has the mark. That is the name of the beast or the number of its name. This calls for wisdom. Let the one who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. This is the word of the Lord. And you can be seated. Now, as I, last week, as I said, as we looked at the first half of this passage, I'll just make a confession to you again. This is a very difficult passage. And preparing a sermon for this has been complicated. What do you talk about? What don't you talk about? What do you leave in? What do you leave out? So I'm just going to confess, I might change things on the fly here. And we might walk away with another jumbled sermon, but we're going to trust that the Lord will at least give us something this morning. And so on that note, let's pray once again. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your word. We thank you that what we have here has been given to us, inspired by the Holy Spirit, instruction for us to give us eyes to see. And so that's what we pray for this morning, Lord. We ask that you would bless the reading of your word. I pray that you would instruct us. I pray for mercy on what I am about to say. And I ask that you would bless it, Lord, that our eyes would be fixed on Jesus and that we would become wise and discerning in the world that we live in. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. So the book of Revelation, it's the apocalypse, as it's known. That word apocalypse comes from the Greek word apocalypsis, which the first verse of Revelation tells us this is the apocalypse of Jesus Christ, and that word means revelation, the revelation of Jesus Christ. And so that word means to reveal. And I think there's two things that are going on when we read that first verse. John is wanting us to know that this book is a revelation about Jesus Christ. We will meet him in this book and learn about him. But it is also a revelation of Jesus Christ that Jesus is going to reveal things to his church in this book. And this is what we did. A very clear example of that is chapter 13. Jesus in a vision is revealing to John how the dragon, Satan, is at work in the world. And he says he's at work in two ways, and they're like beasts. One of the beasts arises out of the sea, and the other one out of the land. And last week we focused on that ferocious sea beast, and we saw how that was it represented ungodly human empires. Right? And for John, as his audience heard those words, they would have automatically equated that with Rome, the Roman Empire. And yet, you know, we would say that Rome didn't look like a monster, right? Rome doesn't look like a monster. It doesn't act like a monster to its citizens. It pretends to be orderly. It's got an air of righteousness. It was seen as a bringer of peace. The Pax Romana, right? This is what they would say, or its propaganda, you know, would tell you it's a bringer of peace. And just like our governments today, governments or empires all around the world, they seek to show themselves as righteous, peaceful, tolerant, caring, you know, virtuous, and all these things. Everybody, you know. You think of the West and Canada and the United States, everybody has their rights, equality for all. But Jesus is saying in these visions what he's saying, he's revealing something. He's saying, look, what looks like this, what looks peaceful, what looks good is in fact a great monster, which is devouring the church. He's revealing this through these images. And after revealing that first beast who is ferocious and who we're told, you know, speaks haughty and haughty words and great blasphemies, in this morning's passage, we're introduced to that second beast, and it really is a prophet of the first beast, or that's how it's kind of imagined, the imagery is. And after we're introduced to the first beast, the church was told to endure. You're going to need to endure. This first beast was kind of seen as outright hostile, violent. With the second beast, the church in verse 18 is told to have wisdom. Gain wisdom, get wisdom, discernment. Because this one is subtle, even gentle, convincing, extremely deceptive. And so let's kind of go into looking at just a little more of this second beast and what he's doing, how he's operating. We're going to see how he operates outside of the church, but also inside of the church. And then we'll get to what you're all waiting for, the buying and selling of the mark of the beast. But you're going to have to endure me for a little while before we get there. So this beast comes out of the earth. And one of the first things I want to draw attention to just quickly is the first beast came out of the sea and the second beast comes out of the earth. Now those are very easy to read over, but they do mean something. In the Bible, there is this imagery of the sea and the land. And usually when things that are kind of equated with the sea are foreign things. Things that were kind of foreign to the people of God. So that first beast representing, human empires and whatnot is like a foreign thing. Rome was a foreign government oppressing the people of God. When the scripture speaks or equates things with land, it's speaking of something that is perhaps more native to God's people. Okay, so something that is a little more in line with God's people. So this second beast is really about worship. So it's about religion. And that's familiar to God's people. And so this second beast will even work through the church. But we're told that this beast he arises out of the land and he's described as having two horns like a lamb. And if you're keen, you'll remember that Jesus in Revelation, when he's on the throne, he's described as having horns. And so this second beast comes looking like Jesus, mimicking Jesus. Right? He comes looking like a lamb, and yet he speaks like a dragon, it says. He's disguised. He comes with this power, and yet he's gentle and subtle, kind and manipulative. This beast is predatory. Like we said, the first beast was loud and blasphemous and obvious in its defiance of God. This second beast is deceptive, influential, and makes the first beast's claims seem plausible, seem attractive. It'll persuade you that this violent thing is actually a good thing. And it says that he does great signs. The second beast inspires people, to make an image of the first beast. Where the first beast, it makes an image of the first beast, causes people to worship it. And so right away, we're to pick up on that religious tones of the description here, where the first beast represented the human governments who despise God and his law. This beast is representing false worship. A distortion of true religion. All people, all mankind has an impulse to worship. And this beast is representative of the dragon's lies which influence men and women and children to worship things other than the true and living God, which draw them away from Christ, which keep them from his gospel. And he's very convincing. Says he does great signs and wonders. Right? He does great signs. Moses in the Old Testament was said to be a prophet who did great signs. So he comes with the authority and the power of Moses. It says that this beast is going to call down fire from heaven in front of men. Again, a reference, we're supposed to think of Elijah. Elijah, another great prophet of God in the Old Testament, had fire fall down onto that. Remember when he was arguing or in battle with the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel? And so this beast is going to come in the same power and authority as these prophets of God. But he is a false prophet. We see this in the way the passage is laid out. It's explicitly told to us in later portions of Revelation. Chapter 16 and such says this beast is a false prophet. Right? A true prophet of God leads people to worship the true and living God. This beast is leading people to worship things other than the true and living God. And so it's all about spreading this lie. And he convincingly leads people away to worship that which is antichrist, that which is against Christ and his church. This beast, again, like the first beast, is proclaiming another way. And he's convincing people of that. And so this beast, as a false prophet, operates outside of the church. And as John's original audience, like when they heard this, they would have automatically thought of, okay, this beast is represented for us in the prophets, in the priests of the imperial cult. This religion that had the Roman citizens worshiping Roman rulers, Caesars, as God. There were temples built and sacrifices that were in place to worship the Roman rulers as God, and so this would have been a natural understanding for them. But this still happens today. People still worship their leaders in this way, and that may seem foreign to us as we sit here, because that doesn't happen necessarily in this land. But this worship of leadership, the worship of the state, you know, it happens. You think of countries. You think of countries that even are, where atheism is the official stance, let's say, of the party or whatever. Even in these countries, it's they sanction worship. It's worship of the leader or the party. In North Korea, people are required to pay homage and worship the leader, not only living, but those who have died. I read recently in Christianity Today, Nate Flanagan reported just a few months ago that Chinese authorities had visited Christian homes and I'm not going to even try to pronounce the name of the village here, but they had visited Christian homes in a particular village and told those residents who were there and who were receiving welfare benefits that they had to take down all crosses and replace any displays of Jesus with portraits of Chairman Mao and President Xi Jinping. And so this is alive and well. In other places of the world, we see this happening. And it sounds a little odd to us as we sit here. Our Western sensibilities don't really understand that kind of religious persecution. Here, the separation of church and state, we feel like we don't have this kind of worship happening. We're not forced by our state or the government of Canada to worship that way or to do those things. But don't be fooled. Mankind, like I said, was made to worship, and it will worship something. And in the West, we have, I would say, we've just embraced self-worship. Right? We worship ourselves. We worship along with ideas and ideologies. We will follow and pay allegiance to the beast that allows us to worship ourselves. We'll worship a state, not directly, but a state who provides for us the best and the good life. Health and prosperity, regardless of whatever else it does, as long as our needs are met, we'll follow. So this is kind of the beast at work outside of the church. But this beast is at work inside of the church. And here's where the subtle, it's very subtle and the danger lies. This is where the call for wisdom really comes in, because the dragon infiltrates the church. In the letter to the seven churches at the very beginning of Revelation, the Lord gave several warnings to those churches about false prophets who were in them. And he warned of the coming judgment. And Jesus warns in Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, in chapter 7, he says to the church, he says, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves." Right here we said the beast looks like a lamb, yet it speaks like a dragon. Right? That whole image of a wolf in lamb's clothing, it speaks of deception. There's traitors, you could say, within the fold of the church. And though they pretend to represent the truth, and they might appear harmless, you know, gentle like a lamb, underneath that, Satan is at work. Satan is at work in the church, seeking to deceive and take you off course. Jesus, again, in Matthew 24, the disciples came to him and said, look, what will be the sign of your coming at the end of the age? And Jesus answered them and said, see to it that no one leads you astray. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and they will lead many astray. Many false prophets will arise and lead many astray. And this is, we're constantly warned of this in the New Testament. There are going to be false prophets. There are going to be false teachers in the church. Paul and Peter, you know, take pains to warn us about this. And we see this in the marks of a false teacher, a false prophet, are many and varied, but here are some of the primary ones that will be present. There is no, what they do is they do not have, they do not see the Word of God as authoritative or inspired. They'll use it, they'll teach from it, but they'll do it in such a way where this isn't the final authority on our faith or the practice of it. So they'll kind of take away that foundation. Secondly, a false teacher, ultimately when you're listening to the hymn, preaches a different message. There's a different message. Because this no longer is the foundation or the authority, what proceeds from them is a subtle but a different message. Right? Peter tells us that for a false teacher, Jesus will end up on the margins. And what they do is they secretly, they'll introduce destructive heresies, which even deny the sovereign Lord who bought them. If you listen carefully to what he's saying, you'll see that Jesus Christ is not essential. Not essential to the message. And then another thing is a false teacher always has a different appeal. The scripture has one appeal, and that is to turn to Jesus Christ, the one who has bled and died for your sins, and confess and repent so that you may receive eternal life in him. That is the appeal of the church. That is the message. A false teacher has a different message. A false teacher asks, what do people want to hear? What will appeal to their flesh? It's subtle. Because it's not like they're, you know, a false teacher's in the church, right? They're wolves in sheep's clothing. They're not blatant and obvious. They're going to use all the language that the church uses. They're going to talk about Jesus. They're going to talk about God. They'll hold the Bible. But there's going to be a subtle difference. And you have to be wise and discerning to pick it up. Or you'd just be led astray. As I was thinking about this, I was thinking like, Claudia and I, you know, we'll be driving sometimes after church. We just go get a coffee and then we'll have a coffee, but we'll go get something to eat for lunch or pick up groceries. And but we'll get into these conversations. We'll be drinking coffee. There'll be, you know, beautiful conversations, whatever we're talking about. She's always loves talking to me because, you know, I impress her and this. No, but we'll be talking. And then before I know it, I've passed Walmart. And I'm in Fruitvale, right? It just, the conversation took away and I missed a turnoff where I should have gone and I didn't. But this is like a false teacher. They'll, you know, you'll be in conversations and everything will seem fine. And then all of a sudden, you know, a little bit down the road, you can think, I'm on the wrong path. What are we doing here? I don't even know how I ended up here. You just kind of get swept up and taken away in it. It's just subtle like this. And some of it is quite obvious, or should be obvious to us. And, you know, there is a lot of blatant false teaching in the church today. I think that we could, and I don't mind at this point, you know, being a little bit bold here, but I think that we have people like Joel Osteen or Kenneth Copeland or people like Paula White who I think are false teachers, who I think are very destructive, who I think have taken the gospel of Jesus Christ and twisted it and made it an extremely ugly, damaging thing, and all they do is appeal to greed. They turn the gospel into this health, wealth, prosperity game. And it's ugly and it's wrong, and that's kind of blatant to us. But like I said, the more subtle teaching often comes about like this. God is love. God is love. That's a truth we all confess. It's biblical, it's in here. But what happens is that this one thing gets used to twist everything else. It gets used to twist everything else about God. So it comes out like, I believe in a God of love. And all God's other attributes like justice and holiness and judgment and righteousness, they get pushed aside. They get downplayed or even denied. Because God's love becomes the determining factor for all things. I should say a distorted image of God's love, right? And so you come to a place where it said, how could a loving God send people to hell? How could a loving God let such and such a tragedy happen? Certainly a loving God will accept people, even people of other religions, if people are out in the world and they genuinely believe, you know, they have a faith and they genuinely believe it, ultimately a loving God is going to honor that and bring them, and they'll end up in heaven. All religions really lead to the same God. I believe in a loving God, and certainly God created me this way, and so I need to embrace all that I am, no matter if I'm walking or living in sin. God loves me for who I am. God is inclusive. God is tolerant. God loves indiscriminately. God never wants his people to suffer. God wants me healthy. God has promised me wealth. All these things are things we like to hear. And that's the more subtle way it comes across. What we're doing is we fashion a God in our own image. And that God is, like was just explained, is a God who is infinitely accepting, inclusive, and tolerant, to the exclusion of all the other things that the scripture reveals about him. And I mean, I have to admit to you, that's certainly an easier message. That's an easier message to preach, to carry out into the world. But here's the thing, what it does is it leads you into the world. That message leads you to compromise with the world. Jesus, you remember, Jesus says to his church, be in the world and not of it. What this does is make you in the world and of it. False teachers in the church encourage compromise with the world. And if we take God and we distort who he is and we distort his gospel, then living in the world becomes pretty easy and comfortable. It becomes easy then to deny the things that Jesus said in the name of love. Right? Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Me alone, there's no other way except through me. But if we can kind of say, well, you know, there is, God will accept other people of other faiths if they're genuine and they believe in this. And then so it's easier for us. Because when we do stand and proclaim to the world that Jesus is the only way, the only truth, the only life, then what happens? Well, you're just bigoted and hateful. And you know what? The church is just so full of hatred. Right? But if we go down the road where we're willing to cast off what we know the Bible says and go in an easier way, living in the world becomes easier. Not only that, is the beast becomes more attractive because he is going to come off as looking as very, very tolerant. The beast is tolerant, supportive, inclusive. We should really take our cues from the beast. You know, I see so much more love in the world than in the church. False teachers within the church are going to take their primary cues from the culture instead of God's word. And yet they're going to persuade people and convince them that they're following God. And this is the point. This is the point of the mark of the beast. It distinguishes those who follow Christ and those who are deceived and follow the beast. Distinguishes those who follow Christ and those who are deceived and follow the beast. And so we arrive at this point where we look at this passage, and in the second beast, it says, is to cause all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both slave and free, to be marked on the right hand and the forehead. And without this mark, they can neither buy or sell. They can't do business. And that mark, we're told, is the number 666. Now, there has been a lot of ink spilt on these verses. Many interpreters have put forth theories and suggestions, which include all kinds of things like we're to be looking for a microchip that is going to be implanted on our hand, perhaps with a barcode. Other believes it's, you know, credit cards or maybe social insurance numbers, you know, SIN numbers. There's all kinds of wild theories about what this mark of the beast, what this 666 will be like that prevents us from buying and selling. And so I'm just going to be honest with you. I don't believe it's any of that. I don't believe that those kind of things have anything to do with what's being talked about here. I believe that this mark is a spiritual mark. And so let me explain. When we read that he marks them on the right hand and on the forehead, this is a reference to Deuteronomy chapter 6. And again, that very famous passage we're all familiar with. I hope you are, because I read it quite a bit here, but it says this. Deuteronomy 6 says, God is giving, it commands to his people. He says, and these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand. And they shall be as frontlets between your eyes on your forehead. Binding God's word, his commands, on their hand and between their eyes on their forehead symbolized that God's ways influenced them. Their thinking. And then worked out through their hands and how they did business. How they did work, how they lived. Those who follow the Lamb are marked by their thoughts and their actions, which honor and follow Christ. Those who follow the beast are marked as his because they identify and they live accordingly, following the beast. And so the mark is spiritual in nature. And so if it's a spiritual sign, how does it affect buying and selling? How does it affect me doing business? And again, if I call your attention back to the original audience as they read this, they would have known automatically. They would have seen the application of this automatically. Because in ancient Rome, everything was bought and sold in the temples. Banking systems ran through the temples. Everything was attached to religion, to either emperor worship or any one of the number of gods. And so people who were wanting to do business in Rome were going to encounter worship of false gods. And even this, and I think I've used this illustration before, but so in the ancient world, if you were a tradesman, let's say if you were a plumber, you belonged to a guild, right? A union, a plumber's union, let's say. Well, in ancient Rome, the plumbers had a god. The god of plumbing. And every year you had to go and you had to worship the god of plumbing at least once. All the plumbers did this because it would bring favor on their plumbing. As a Christian plumber, I can't go and worship the god of plumbing. And so then I'm frowned upon and I lose business. And my other plumbers recognize this in my town. And so in a very real way, they're being stopped from making a living. They're making money to buy food for their families is impacted. This happens today. I know a businessman who develops land and he built a hotel, and when you build a hotel, you want to put a brand name on it because that brings more business for you, right? So if you build a hotel, let's put a Travelodge or Best Western on it. But when you do that, when you brand your hotel, those companies have things you must provide, right? You have to provide a kitchen downstairs for free breakfast, right? So after he built his hotel and he was looking for which brand to put on it, he was shocked to find that even there were companies who you could not put their name on your hotel if you were not willing to provide pornography. This impacts business. That's the work of the beast. Bringing sin, manipulative and deceptive, and the Christian is standing there, what do I do? You've put all this money into this building. Do I just acquiesce? Or do I take a blow and just put out some name, some unknown name hotel? I'm going to lose business. But it requires a difficult decision. That's one example of how this plays out in our life. This is a spiritual mark. It's an attitude, a mindset. There's the way of Christ or the way of the beast. In this world, only those who worship the beast and accept his mark, who engage fully in the system, are really, really going to succeed. Only those who will abide the evils of the system, are willing to compromise, will gain from it. And while that whole identification with the beast will give them temporary prosperity in this life, they will ultimately lose it in the next. They will be eternally punished. And this is an incredibly powerful, cunning, deceitful strategy of the dragon. right? Because when you think about it, in one sense, it would be really easy if the mark of the beast was a, you know, a credit card or a barcode, you know, or a tattoo of 666. I don't think there's anybody, Christian or non-Christian, who's going to go and let the government put a tattoo of 666 on the right hand or their forehead, right? It seems pretty simple. People are going to be like, yeah, not doing that mark. Not going to go down that path. But it becomes infinitely more difficult when what this is talking about is rejecting the power, the influence, the wealth and prosperity that Satan offers to entice us away from Christ. To say, instead of compromising with the world, instead of entering into its evil, instead of profiting from it when I know there's corruption there, I am going to choose to take a blow to my own, to myself, perhaps my family, my finances, my prosperity, and I'm going to choose to do that because I am going to follow the Lamb of God. And so what this is calling for is a searching of our hearts and our minds to evaluate our choices, to evaluate our love for Christ. Are we willing to follow him wherever he goes, even at great cost to ourselves? It's a very real message for the church today. Those who follow Christ are called to refuse to be identified with the beast. And the result of that refusal will be suffering. There will be consequences in the past, presently, on around in different areas of the world, and in the future, it will be great cost, even death. But the ultimate reward for those who do so are eternal life. Our witness for Christ is seen powerfully when we reject the evils of the world, when we refuse to be part of the system which denies Jesus Christ and promotes all kinds of evil. And this may seem overwhelming, and I know I'm closing up here. But take heart. I want to leave on that note, take heart, because those who follow Christ have been marked not with the beast, but with the Holy Spirit. Have been marked with the Holy Spirit. And so those who are marked by the Holy Spirit are protected by the power of his name. They're protected from deception. It won't fall into the beast's lies. And if you believe in him, his name on you means his presence in you. And the Holy Spirit's work in you is to make you more like Christ, to make you desire what Christ desires, to make you love the things that Christ loves. And so you follow him and you resist. You hate what Christ hates. And you resist the work of the beast and his lies and his deception. Amen. I'm going to stop there. And I know someone, this just popped into my mind. Richard, you can come up here. Someone's asked me, well, what does 666 mean? So here's my understanding of 666, and you can take this or leave it, because there's lots of stuff, lots of different things. 7 is a number of perfection. 6 is a number of imperfection. 7 has been known as the number of God. 6 is the number of man that falls short of God. And I think that, and it's a number, 7 is a number of completeness. 6 is a number of incompleteness. 3 is also a number of completeness. And so if you put 666 together, it's completely incomplete. And I think that's just kind of the mockery of the number of the beast. Is that, and there's 3 sixes there because there's the dragon, the first and the second beast. They're completely incomplete. They fail at everything ultimately. So that's my take on 666. And I'll close there. Okay. There you go.
Well, I invite you to stand as we sing.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.